सो वेलकम टू लेक्चर 3. दिस इज द कैडकैम सीएई लेक्चर सीरीज एंड दिस इज लेक्चर 3. इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ टू डायमेंशनल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशंस. वी विल फर्स्ट ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड द बेसिक ट्रांसफॉर्मेशंस, बेसिक टू डायमेंशनल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशंस, ओके, देयर मीनिंग्स and then their matrix representations, and then slowly we'll move to the other types of transformations, and then in the next part we will see some of the examples how these transformations are carried out using matrix operations. So let's get started. So geometric transformations, okay, what exactly we mean by transformations or in general geometric transformations. So design applications and facility layouts are created by arranging the orientations and sizes of the component parts of the scene. So whatever we see, let's say for example, if we are watching a movie. So in that movie also, okay, if you are watching the movie on different devices, let's say you are watching a movie in a movie theater, okay, the same movie when you watch on your say 42 inch television, and when the same movie you watch on your laptop, or let's say for example a mobile device, okay, what do you see? You see size differences, okay, you see size differences, layout differences, okay. So that's what they are saying. Design applications and facility layouts are created by arranging the orientations and sizes of the component parts of the scene. So if your device changes, the sizes are going to change, okay, but the original picture remains the same, okay. So how that part is made possible, okay, so that is all made possible with the help of transformations, and for that example geometric transformations, and there are viewing transformations later which we are going to study. So first we will concentrate on geometric transformations, and then we will slowly try to understand what are exactly viewing transformations, okay, from the display device point of view. Okay, the animations are produced by moving the camera or the objects in a scene along animation paths. Okay, changes in orientation, size and shape are accomplished with geometric transformations that alter the coordinate descriptions of the object. Okay, so that's what I said. Okay, the orientation, size and shape are accomplished with geometric transformations. So you can actually change, alter, modify the sizes, okay, based on the requirements. Okay. One more simple example I can give is, okay, in softwares like AutoCAD, okay, when you create a square or a rectangle, okay, when you try to zoom the view, okay, zoom the view, the rectangle goes bigger and bigger, okay, and at certain point of time it goes out of the screen. Okay, this is what we call as the changes that happens at a viewing level. Okay, and the other thing what we can do is we try to scale the object. So you select the object, you apply a scaling factor, and the object actually turns into a bigger object. Okay, so that is what we call as a geometric transformation. So transforming the object, okay, transforming the object, transforming means changing its size, shape completely, okay, and converting it into a new object. That is what we mean by transformations. Geometric transformation means, okay, trying to achieve this at a geometry level. Now, what are the geometry levels? Geometry levels are the coordinates of that particular object. So, if we stick to our Cartesian coordinate system, okay, in the initial phase, we will concentrate only on the two-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system, including x and y axis. Okay, so in that two-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system, okay, we will have coordinate for each and every point, okay, of the object. Say for example, if we are representing a line, okay, then it will have a start ending point and the end ending point, or you can say starting point and ending point. Okay, so starting point will have x1 comma y1 as the coordinate, and ending point will have x2 comma y2 as the coordinate. Okay, now when I am transforming this line, okay, so I will get new set of coordinates for starting point as well as ending point depending on which transformation I am applying. So we are all dealing with geometric transformations. Okay, we are all dealing with geometric transformation. So I was just saying, okay, I have a line, let's say for example, okay, this is the line that I have. Okay, let's say this is the starting point of the line, this is the ending point of the line. Okay, so this is having coordinates x1 comma y1, and the end point is, let's say, x2 comma y2. Let's say if I scale this line to 1.5 times, so the new line would be something like this. Okay, something like this. And the new coordinates would become, let's say, x1 dash, y1 dash, and here x2 dash and y2 dash. Okay, so what I did, I transformed the line. Okay, I transformed the line. So this is what the geometric transformations means. Okay, now what are the basic transformations? So basic geometric transformations involve translation, rotation and scaling. Okay, and there are other two transformations which are reflection, what we also call it as mirror. Okay, reflection, which is also called as mirror transformation. Okay, in all the 3D modeling tool, okay, mirror operation is very famous. So it is also called as mirror. And the fifth transformation is shear transformation. So at the first instance, we will see these three transformations at the beginning. Okay, translation, rotation and scaling. And then in the next half, we will see the reflection and shear in details. Okay, so okay, translation. So translation is applied to an object, okay, by repositioning it along a straight line path from one coordinate location to another coordinate location. Okay, so we translate a two-dimensional point by adding translation distances, let's say tx and ty, to the original coordinate position x comma y, to move the point to a new coordinate position. So let's say x dash y dash is a new coordinate position. The current coordinate position of that point is x comma y, so x plus tx. Now tx is a translational distance in x, okay, and ty is a translational distance in y direction. So translation distance pair, which is tx comma ty, is called a translation vector or shift vector. So it is something like this, as you can see in this example. So I have this point p over here, okay, which was moved from, let's say, this location x comma y to this new location, okay, x dash comma y dash. Okay, x dash comma y dash. So what we did, we applied a, can see how to find this translation distance along x. So as you can see, this is the translation distance along x. And this is the translation distance along y. Okay, this is the translation distance along y. So now what has happened in turn? This point was translated from this x comma y position to x dash comma y dash position, which is a new position. So what exactly we are doing? We are just adding the distances along respective axis to the current position and finding out the new position. So what we can say over here is, let's say the new position let me put it in bracket, is equal to current position plus translation vector. What I did, current position plus translation vector. So the new position is what? X dash y dash. Now here I am representing it in matrix. Okay, I'll just brief how I did that. Okay, the current position is x comma y plus the translation vector is tx and ty. Okay, now if I write over here, okay, so I have to just find out, okay, how much distance the x coordinate was translated. So that I can just write over here by saying x dash, which is the new position, is equal to x plus tx, and the new position y dash is equal to y plus ty, because these are the individual distances with respect to x and y axis, okay, by which the point was translated respectively in x and y axis. So I can very well write these two equations, and when I try to combine them in a matrix, okay, I get this matrix equation. So these are my linear equations and this is my matrix equation. So normally in a computer language, okay, when we are performing any operation, okay, computer understands rows and columns. Okay, it's very easy for computer to deal in rows and columns. So that is why mostly you will find the operational part, okay, the equations are used are always matrix equations. So we try to convert everything in a matrix equation and then we try to solve. Because computer can handle iterative processes in a matrix orientation very fast. So the speed of the solving, okay, is drastically increasing, okay, in matrix formulations while we are solving the sets, while we are solving the equations on computer. So that is the reason why you will always see we will try to form the equations, okay, linear equations, and then we'll convert them into matrix form, and it's always easy to deal with matrix equations. So this is the translation operation, the first basic transformation, which is translation, to translate a point in an xy plane from a one location to the other location. Okay, and always remember, the new position is equal to current position plus the translation vector in this particular case. Okay, so new position is equal to current position plus translation vector. We'll move ahead. We'll see the second thing, which is the rotation. Now what is happening in rotation? As you can see over here, okay, I have this x comma y point. Okay, so let us just name this point as P and the new position as, let's say, P dash. Okay, so point P is at x comma y, and this particular point is the origin point. Okay, this particular point is point O, which is origin. Okay, so it is at radial distance. So if I join this xy with origin, okay, it forms radius. Okay, and that radius is given as r. So this is r over here. It is not visible. This is r. Okay, this particular thing is r. Okay, which is the radius, and it makes an angle phi with respect to the horizontal x-axis. So this is my x. Okay, and the vertical axis is y-axis. Okay, so it makes an angle phi with respect to the x-axis. Now when I try to rotate it, okay, now this particular point I am trying to rotate here, okay, this particular point will be rotated here, so say this will be the path of the rotation. So that way the point will reach to its new position, which is p dash, and its new coordinates are x dash and y dash, and the point is rotated with respect to origin. Okay, the rotation will happen from the origin. Okay, and it is by default, as you can see. So if I have a third axis over here, okay, if I had a third axis which is perpendicular to the plane, which will be the z axis, so actually the rotation is happening with respect to z axis. Okay, with respect to z axis. So it is just in a similar way as we use our compass, okay, to draw circles. So that way we are just in a counterclockwise direction, rotating the point from its current position x comma y to new position x dash comma y dash by an angle theta with respect to, again, you can say x axis only. We are measuring it from x axis, so in a counterclockwise direction. Okay, in a counterclockwise direction, that is very important. So the counterclockwise direction we will always take as positive direction. Okay, we will always take as positive direction. So in this particular case, if we try to see few equations, okay, if we try to see few equations, so the first, okay, the first triangle that we can form is this particular triangle. Okay, this, let's name it as triangle 1 and this triangle 2. Okay, so in triangle 1, okay, if I try to find out the cos theta and sin theta values, okay, cos theta and sin theta values, then I can easily find them. Or in other words, if I have to find the values of x and y, okay, values of x and y in terms of cos theta and sin theta, okay, in terms of cos theta and sin theta and the radius r, okay, then it is very easy to find. So in other words, for this particular triangle, if I have to find the value of sin theta, it is going to be this side divided by the hypotenuse, okay, this side divided by the hypotenuse. Now this side is what? It is y coordinate. Okay, it is y coordinate divided by r is equal to sin theta. Okay, y coordinate divided by r is equal to sin theta. So let us just write it over here. Okay, sin phi is equal to y by r, and similarly cos phi is equal to x by r. So from here I can easily write x is equal to r cos phi and y is equal to r sin phi. So this is first set of equation which we got. Okay, x equal to r cos phi, y equal to r sin phi. Okay, now similar ways, okay, we can also find similar set of equations for x dash and y dash. Remember, x and y are my current positions, or now you can say once it is rotated, the old positions, and the new positions are going to be x dash and y dash. So if I have to similarly find for triangle 2, okay, so triangle 2 also I can find same things, but in that what is going to happen is, okay, this sine of the angle, okay, now this angle is what? Phi plus this theta. So now the angle is going to be phi plus theta. Okay, if I have to find the sine of this big angle, that big angle is what? Addition of this small angle phi plus this angle theta. Okay, so I can write again in a similar way, sine of phi plus theta is equal to y dash by r, and cos of phi plus theta is equal to x dash by r. Okay, so once this is clear, okay, now we can again rearrange it in a known format, which is x dash is equal to r cos phi plus theta, y dash is equal to r sin phi plus theta. Let me write it clearly. Sin phi plus theta. Now we also know that, okay, when I write cos phi plus theta, okay, it's an addition formula. So I can apply cos a plus b formula and sin a plus b formula and expand the bracket. Okay, so that I will do. So cos phi plus theta is given as cos phi cos theta minus sin phi sin theta. And sin phi plus theta is given as sin phi cos theta plus cos phi sin theta. So it eventually turns out to be, okay, I'll keep r in multiplication at both the equations. So r multiplied by cos phi cos theta minus sin phi, again multiplied by r sin phi sin theta. And as far as y dash is concerned, it is r sin phi cos theta plus r cos phi sin theta. So these are my equation sets of two. Now when I combine equations 1 and 2, what I get? Okay, when I combine equations 1 and 2, what I get? I get, as you can see, wherever I have got r cos phi term, r sin phi term, okay, I will replace it with x and y respectively. Okay, so x is r cos phi and y is r sin phi. So eventually when I do that, okay, here I have, as you can see, this is r cos phi, this is r sin phi, okay, and then here this is r sin phi and this is r cos phi. So I will use the known values from equation 1 and rewrite x dash and y dash, x dash and y dash. So r cos phi is x cos theta, okay, minus y sin theta, and here r sin phi is again y cos theta plus r cos phi is x sin theta. Now if I have to arrange this, okay, if I have to arrange this in a matrix order, okay, I have to see that, okay, x and y, the place of x and y are retained. So instead of writing, let's say, y dash as y cos theta plus x sin theta, I will rewrite it as x sin theta plus y cos theta. So let me just erase this once again. Or yeah, so I'm not changing anything. I'm just bringing this term ahead. So it is, so this is going to help us to create a matrix form. So x sine theta plus y cos theta. Okay, now these two, if I try to convert it into a matrix form, on the left hand side I will get a column matrix of x dash, y dash is equal to, here I will get a 2 by 2 square matrix which will have cos theta minus sin theta, sin theta and cos theta term multiplied by the old coordinates which is x and y. Okay, so this is the transformation matrix. So as you can see in a notation form, this is the notation or the coordinates of P dash. This is the transformation matrix multiplied by the original coordinates which is P. Okay, so as you can see over here, okay, the rotation matrix, the transformation, okay, gives us the transformation matrix multiplied by the old coordinates. And if you remember in the previous example translation, the matrix notations were like the old coordinates plus the translation coordinates. Okay, now just remember these two differences. Okay, so this is as far as rotation is concerned. So what we did, this object was rotated in a counterclockwise direction or anticlockwise direction to a new position, and with the help of, and that was rotated by an angle theta. So by an angle theta, so theta is only this rotation. Okay, but this point already is at angle phi. Okay, so what we did actually by doing all these calculations, we eliminated phi from the equations and only retained the rotation angle theta. So now you can see in the rotational matrices, okay, we have only theta value and no phi value. Okay, because phi value is not required as far as doing calculations are concerned. Okay, so only the rotation angle theta is required. So if the question is asked, they will ask you to rotate the object by an angle theta, okay, in counterclockwise direction or clockwise direction. Now remember, this is a positive rotation, so counterclockwise direction is considered as positive direction. So if a question is asked, rotate in a clockwise direction, at that time you have to take theta as negative. Now here remember, we have taken theta as positive. Theta is positive, okay, in counterclockwise direction. So this is very important statement. Okay, theta is positive in counterclockwise direction, and if it is clockwise given, then theta has to be negative. Okay, theta has to be negative. So just remember this. So this is as far as rotation is concerned. So we'll move ahead. Okay, the third thing is a scaling transformation. Okay, scaling transformation. Now scaling transformation is also very easy to understand. Okay, so scaling transformation alters the size of an object. So far what we have seen, we have just changed, we have just played with the locations of the, or the orientation of the object. So in first, it was just translated from one location to another location. The size of the object is still intact. Okay, in the second case, it was just rotated. Okay, still the size of the object is intact. Okay, so if it's a square, okay, of say some dimension, okay, after translation, it is still gonna remain square of that same dimension. After rotation also, it is gonna remain square of the same dimension. Okay, but when we apply scaling, which is the third basic transformation operation, okay, the size of the object is going to change. Okay, so if the size is x by y, okay, for square or rectangle, let's say x by y, then after scaling factor, let's say 2, the size will become 2x by 2y. Okay, if it is a uniform scaling we are applying. So scaling is going to alter the size of the object. Now we are playing with the actual size of the object or size or shape of the object. Shape in scaling, if it is uniform scaling, shape will not change. Square will remain square, rectangle will remain rectangle. But if it is non-uniform scaling, then square can become rectangle or rectangle can become square, or let's say other forms can also be achieved, okay, by changing the scaling factors differently. So as you can see, I have, let's draw something just to give an example. So here I have rectangle. Okay, so if I apply a scaling factor of, let's say, 2, the rectangle will become bigger. And it will, let's say, slightly move away from the origin as well. So why it moves away from the origin, that we will see. Okay, but what we applied a scaling factor. So size of the object changes. Okay, size of the object changes. So let's say a new position, as far as the equation form is concerned, the new position, which is x dash, is equal to, there is some scaling factor, let's say sx, multiplied by the old coordinate x. And similarly, y dash is given by scaling factor in terms of y multiplied by the y coordinate. Now when I combine this in a matrix form, what I get? I get x dash sx 0 0 sy multiplied by the old coordinates xy, okay, multiplied by the old coordinates xy. So now this is, let's say, a new position in a notation form. This is p dash. Okay, this is a transformation matrix for scaling multiplied by the original coordinate matrix p. So this is also in a multiplication form. Okay, scaling is also in a multiplication form. Okay, sx and sy are called as scaling factors, okay, in x direction and y direction. Okay, so okay, scaling factor in x axis, sy scaling factor in y axis. So as far as the scaling is concerned, okay, it is fairly simple. Just always you can say scaling factors will adjust themselves along the major diagonal of the square matrix. Okay, along the major diagonal of the transformation matrix of for scaling. So as you can see, this and this location, this is a major diagonal and this is always the minor diagonal. So major diagonal, along the major diagonal. So if we add on the axis, we will have a third axis. So SZ will come over here. We'll see that later. But they will always arrange themselves in the major diagonal, along the major diagonal. Okay, so the multiplication is also very easy and we get results quite quickly. Okay, quite quickly. So this is the third scaling. Now, okay, if you remember, if we go back, let's say, okay, in translation, what we said, okay, in translation, this was the new position. I just write this in a notation form. This is the new position p dash, which is equal to, let's bring this transformation matrix for translation first. and plus the old position, which is P. So as you can see, this is what we did for translation. So transformation matrix plus the old coordinates. Okay, in rotation what we did, transformation matrix multiplied by the old coordinates. In scaling what we did, transformation matrix for scaling multiplied by the old coordinates. So now there is no uniformity. Okay, if we have translation, we have to multiply, and if there is rotation and scaling, if there is translation, we have to add, and if there is rotation and scaling, we have to multiply. So there is no uniformity between the two. So in order to bring the uniformity between the two, why uniformity is required? Let's say I tell you, rotate the square by 30 degree, translate it by 20 units in x and 30 units in y, and then scale it by 2, okay, in x and 2 in y. If I say like this, so if there are chain of operations, let's say one operation followed by the other, and then some result is expected, then in that case the matrix operations should be uniform. Okay, there should be uniformity in the operations of matrices, and if that uniformity is not there, then these simultaneous transformation operations will not be carried out. So in order to bring the uniformity in the matrix operations for different transformations, okay, we use a homogeneous coordinate system. Okay, we use a homogeneous coordinate system. So what is homogeneous coordinate system? We can combine the multiplicative and translational terms for two-dimensional geometric transformations into a single matrix representation by expanding the 2x2 matrix representations to a 3x3 matrices. Okay, so this allows us to express all transformation equations as matrix multiplications, providing that we also expand the matrix representations for coordinate positions. Okay, so to express any two-dimensional transformation as a matrix multiplication, we represent each Cartesian coordinate position, which is xy, with a homogeneous coordinate triplet or triple, which is xh, yh, h. Okay, xh, yh, h, where x is given as xh divided by h, y is given as yh divided by h. Okay, and normally this h is taken as unity. Okay, normally this h is taken as unity. So when we write, let's say, xh by h, yh by h, and h, okay, so eventually it turns out to be xh, yh, and h by h turns out to be 1. So we have a third notation, okay, which doesn't represent any dimension. So this is still a two-dimensional representation, but with a homogeneous coordinate h. Okay, homogeneous coordinate h, it just gives us a uniformity in all the operations. Okay, it just gives us uniformity in all the operations, and its value is always going to remain 1. Okay, its value is always going to remain 1, and that is the reason why, okay, we do not even write this x, h and y, h anymore, because since h becomes 1, okay, so we will also do not represent these subscripts h everywhere. Okay, now, so from now on, we will always represent all the coordinates in homogeneous coordinates. The reason is, okay, it gives us the uniformity and it turns all the operations in a multiplicative manner. Okay, in a multiplicative manner. So we'll just see that in the next slide. As you can see for translation, which is x dash y dash 1, which is the new position. Now how it is given? 1 0 tx. Now here is the translational coordinate or translation factor in terms of x coming into picture. Okay, it is not that visible, I'll just rewrite over here again. Okay, x dash y dash 1. So this is that homogeneous coordinate 1 coming from. Okay, now how it is arranged? It is 1 0, and here that tx is coming. then 0, 1, and here this ty is coming, and then 0, 0, 1 is the third row for the homogeneous coordinate, multiplied by the old coordinates x, y, 1. So now always the coordinates will be represented as x, y, 1. That 1 is going to come by default. Okay, so now this is the transformation matrix for translation. Okay, as far as rotation and scaling is concerned, okay, there is not much change happening. So this is cos theta minus sin theta cos theta. This was as we did it in 2 by 2 representation. Now in a 3 by 3 representation in homogeneous coordinates, okay, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. So third row and third column is getting added with the values exactly same as 0, 0, 1. So third row is 0, 0, 1, third column is also 0, 0, 1. And multiplied by x, y, 1, which is the old coordinates. And same goes with the scaling. So scaling factor sx, 0, 0, sy, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, sx 0 0 sy 0 0 0 0 1. If that is also not visible, I'll just rewrite that again over here. As far as scaling is concerned, x dash y dash 1 is equal to sx 0 0 0 sy 0 0 0 1. Multiplied by the old coordinates, which is x, y, 1. Now, as you can see, all are in multiplication form. Okay, let us rewrite this also. Why to leave this? So, new position x dash, y dash, 1. Okay, the transformation matrix for rotation. This is cos theta, okay, minus sine theta, 0. Then sin theta, cos theta, 0, and then 0, 0, 1, multiplied by the old coordinates x, y, 1. Okay, so this is as far as the basic transformations are concerned, and remember, we are following a column representation. Okay, we are following a column representation. Column representation means the coordinate matrix. Okay, the coordinate matrix, which is this new coordinate matrix and old coordinate matrix. Okay, these matrices are represented as column matrices. Okay, it is also possible to represent these matrices as row matrices. Okay, and you can also have the row representations. Okay, but we are not going to follow row representations. The column representation comes as a natural. Okay, so if you write the simultaneous set of equations and when you convert them into a matrix form, okay, you get a column representation of matrix. Okay, you get a column representation of matrix. So just remember, always we will be having a column representation of matrix, and from now onwards we are always going to follow the homogeneous coordinates even for two-dimensional problems. Okay, two-dimensional set of problems. So for two-dimensional problems, the order of matrix is going to be 3 by 3. The transformation matrix will be a square matrix which will be of the order 3 by 3, and we will see when we will deal with three-dimensional problems, the transformation matrix order will increase by 1, okay, and it will become 4 by 4. So as far as the basic transformations are concerned, which are translation, rotation and scaling, okay, we have completed the derivation part, or you can say deriving the transformation matrices for all these three basic transformations. In the coming lecture, we will see the set of problems, okay, on these basic transformations. We'll work out few examples and try to understand in more convincing manner how the concatenations are happening. Concatenations are the simultaneous transformation. Say you rotate, then you scale, then you translate in any sequence, okay, in any sequence these operations can be carried out, and how to find out the resultant coordinates, okay, for the part. So we'll stop for the today's lecture, and if you have any queries, you can always come back to me. Thank you.